Just help us to come alive and help us to be excited and passionate about who you are and about what you're doing in and through us, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. I have a video that I want to show you guys first off. Before I share from the book of Romans again. And this morning's going to be good. It's going to be a powerful morning. Yeah, I can feel it. So we're actually going to have to turn that probably light off again. John just turned it on. But Steve, if you could grab that light, that would be a really good thing. And
I was talking to my boys about this the other day. We have this little family tradition of talking about how we are the Furticks. We're real proud of our family. And when they do something out of character with what the Furtick family does, I'll tell them, Furtick boys don't blank. Fill in the blank. You get many opportunities to do this when your kids are in preschool. Furtick boys share. Furtick boys don't argue. And the other day, Elijah was telling me about how one of the kids in his class told a lie. And I said, Elijah, you don't need to tattle on this little boy. Why are you telling me this? He said, that's right. I just need to focus on myself, don't I? Because Furtick boys don't lie, and Furtick boys don't tattle. When you know who you are, Furtick boy, you know what to do. Don't lie. Don't tattle. I know it's simple, but it'll change your life. Because so many people, what's God want me to do? Who has he called you to be? Holy and blameless, adopted as his sons. Isn't it interesting that in Matthew chapter 3, verse 17, when Jesus came to be baptized by John in the Jordan River, God said, this is my beloved son with whom I am well pleased. God said this about his son Jesus before Jesus ever performed a public miracle. Why? Because identity comes before activity. And when you try to find out what is God's will for your activity before you're secure in your identity, you end up having a crisis in your life.
Let me turn them back on, those lights. I watched that, and I thought it was really good. And I've struggled with that over and over and over and over again. Understanding in theory that, man, those iPhone 5s, they kill me.
Thanks.
Understanding in theory that, and doctrinally, that I'm saved by grace and I don't have to do anything to, you know, to make God more pleased with me than just loving him and surrendering to him and all that. But in practice, I often felt just like I wasn't measuring up. Anyone ever feel that before? Like you're not measuring up. And even as I still struggle with it to this day, if I'm honest, even last night I was sitting there going, God, I don't feel like I have any capability whatsoever in and of myself to win people to you or build this church or do anything of spiritual value for that matter. I'm like, what do I do? And I just sat there kind of in wondering what I could possibly do more for God than what I've been doing, which is like pressing in and just witnessing to people and inviting everyone I can up to church. And I'm like, when is it gonna break again? And when are we gonna start to experience that, you know, momentum and growth? Because like that's exciting when it comes to church. It's like it's exciting when, for me, when there's lots of people and there's activity and there's things happening. And I just felt like I was reminded of that scripture where Jesus said, you know, I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. And I realized just afresh how how much God was interested in my heart before he's interested in my actions. You know what I mean? Oftentimes, I think that we neglect the heart and focus in on our actions, and then we do a bunch of stuff thinking that that's going to make him proud of us when he's already proud of us and he already favors us. And then the problem with that the way of thinking is when we fail, we feel like I've displeased him now and God's mad at me. When in fact, his heart never changes towards us. He actually never thinks differently about you than he thinks right now, which is, I love you, you're my beloved, you're worthy because of Jesus, you're in my son, you know, heaven is your eternal reward, and on and on and on and on it goes. And he never changes, his stance toward you doesn't change, he's unchangeable. Jesus Christ, he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. We know that in theory, but our culture values performance, and so I get caught in this performance mentality sometimes where I think I have to stand up here on a Sunday morning or whenever and like wow people, and God's like, stop it, stop it, stop it, stop it. You can't impress me. I'm already impressed. You can't make me smile more at you than I'm smiling right now. Obviously, there's a sense when we step out in faith, you know, sometimes we feel him smiling more at us. But I don't think it's because he's smiling more at us. I just think when we're in that, when we can see with the eyes of faith, we just actually see it more. We experience it more. And so on that note, I just want to open up with Romans 1 again. Is that good? Do you guys ever struggle with that too?
Yeah.
Feeling like just down because you're not doing good enough. And God's like, he wants you to do good, and there's a value in discipline for sure. But his heart, I believe what empowers us to walk that way is seeing his unchanging heart and living a life of response to that and walking in the Spirit. He actually never changes his heart toward us. It's such an awesome, awesome truth. And I really like this clip because it speaks to me about how we need to know whose we are before we can find out who we are. I would propose to you that the main struggle inside of most hearts, most Christian hearts, probably, maybe even your heart this morning, is this: who am I? Like, what's inside of me, and what am I really created for? And maybe the question, like, how come it's not happening on you know, when I want it to happen, and we have all these questions. But I believe that the more we rest in him and our identity in him and understanding I belong to Christ Jesus, that's why I love, I just want to reiterate, if you can go to that first slide. I know that we're preaching through the book of Romans, and Paul opens up this letter and says, Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, and he identifies himself as belonging to Jesus. Before he even says anything about doctrine or anything about him or anything about what he's called to do, he connects it and says, called to be an apostle. But before he even says his function in the body of Christ, he says, I belong to Jesus. I'm the servant of Jesus. In fact, we mentioned last week that word actually means a bond slave. It means a bond servant, someone who's connected, like, by the hip to Jesus. And it's in that place, I believe, that we start to find out that who we really are. And so that's why I opened with that. I thought it was exciting. You guys good? was listening to a preacher this week, and he said, man, I've said this before through the years, but I think it's true. He said, man, he said, white people will kill a preacher. And I'm like, you need to get yourself some black people in your church. Oh, it was funny. It's so, whatever you are, Brandon, you got some mix there, so he thinks he's black, but so spur me on this morning, because I need it. Sometimes, you know, people just look at you, and even though they say, you ask them after, man, you look like you're just suffering through my message. They're like, no, it was really good, but when you look at me like this, it's kind of tough, so I don't know what's going on there. What was that?
I said, it's moisturizing my eyes. My eyes are watering.
Okay, so let's go to the fourth slide. We're going to go to verse 8 this morning. Oh, the next one. So Paul says, and we're going to cover verses 8 to 14 this morning. It says this, first, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for you all because your faith is proclaimed in all the world. And I was just thinking about that, and I am determining in my heart, I have determined in my heart, and I am determining in my heart to be a man of faith. And faith is a vast subject. I mean, it's the way that we enter the kingdom is through faith. But faith is this, it's the God-given ability he's given to each one of us to see with the eyes of our heart that which hasn't come into manifestation yet. And so faith is the ability for me to see, like I have a real heart for young people. I have a heart I have a heart for everybody, but I got a heart for youth. And so right now, by faith, I see in my spirit this particular room filled, like packed all the way to the back, with lots of different people, all ages, it's all good. I love everybody, I love you all, even if you're even if you're 100 years old, I love you. But with so many young people and this whole kind of area just, you know, packed out, people dancing, glorifying God, I actually see that. I don't know if you see it. I want you to see it. That's how you become a viable contributor to any church, is you start to see with the eyes of faith instead of seeing with the eyes of the natural, in the natural. You've got to see with faith. Paul is pumped up and he's saying, I've never met you guys before, but I thank my God through Jesus Christ for you all because your faith is proclaimed in all the world. I just want to declare that our faith, I believe the faith of this church, Dunamis Church, Sarnia, the faith of the church in this city will be proclaimed in the world. I believe, personally, I just think I'm crazy to believe this, but I just believe it. I believe that the nations are going to know the name Sarnia. Is that all right?
Yeah. Amen.
They know the name Narnia, but they're going to know the name Sarnia because of your faith. And because I see it right now. I actually see by faith, now we already have drums, but I see in not too long from now, a drum set here and bass guitar at the back, and already got Austin on the keys here. I see by faith that we're not going to have this sound system here for very long. What we're going to do is we're going to get one of those fat cords that has everything in it, the snake, and run all the way to the back. The sound's going to be at the back. And this whole area is going to be cleared out, and we're going to probably hang a projector. Maybe if we can do that. I don't know if we can. But somehow, and this area is going to be more cleared out. I see it by faith.
Amen.
And it's already happened. What we do is, as we just see who we are in Christ, and as we see, man, I just belong to Jesus. It's my natural function to love him and love people and bring people into God's kingdom. It's just el natural for me to be crazy about inviting people to church and getting on fire for God, getting people stoked up for Jesus and talking about him and loving him and bringing my Bible to school or work or wherever I go and going on prayer walks. It's just, it's natural. It's not, you know, when you tap into your eyes of faith, you begin to see that. Does that make sense? I see that right now. And so I labor toward that end because I don't have anything else. Like, it's what's consumed my heart. God has consumed my heart and his vision, not just for me, but I believe for you and for this church, has consumed my heart. So that's a good thing. I just prophesy that forth in Jesus' name. The next verse says, "For God is my witness, whom I serve with my spirit in the gospel of his Son. Without ceasing, I mention you." God is my witness, whom I serve with my spirit in the gospel of his Son. I was thinking about that, and I don't know about you, but sometimes I get tired of trying to serve God. Like, God, I'm serving you, I'm doing what I can. And oftentimes he just says to me, he's like, stop it. Like, stop serving you. He's like, don't stop serving me, but stop. Like, I wanna change the way that you're going about this. Paul said, I serve God with my spirit. I believe that's where it starts, and that's really the only way that we can serve God is with our spirit. I personally believe that, and from a biblical standpoint of view, that there's really nothing, there's no way that we can honor God except through our spirits. We can't, you know, do enough for him. He is interested. He's a God of the heart. He's a God of the spirit. He's a God who sees and knows everything. John 4, verse 24 says, "God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth, because there's no other way. There's no other way. If I lift my hands up to him and I say, I worship you, if it's not coming out of my spirit, it's just an action. It's a mere action. You know, if I'm singing him songs, if I'm listening to preaching, but I'm not listening with the eyes of my heart and with the eyes of my spirit, it just, you know, it just falls on deaf ears. One of the most interesting passages in scripture is in a couple of the gospels where the Bible says that, actually, I think it's just in the Gospel of Luke, actually. The Bible says that Herod, the guy who killed John the Baptist, it says that Herod used to love to go hear John preach, and he heard him often, and he heard him gladly. And Herod was a king, and he went and he used to listen to John the Baptist's sermons, and then a year later, put him in prison, and then a little while later, beheaded him. I would propose that there's many in church that are listening with their natural ears, but not listening with their spirits. And Paul said, "I serve God with my spirit." This really came alive to me as I was fasting this week, and just praying. And I'm like, my God, like, I don't know. I sometimes you forget how much of a part of our culture revolves around food, like utterly revolves around food. It's crazy. And like it's like we think about it all the time. Like, we get up in the morning and we think, you know, we break our fast, right? Isn't that true? Breakfast, break fast. That's what it means. Break your fast, because you fasted all night as you're sleeping. And you break your fast in the morning, breakfast. And then you're thinking, around 11 o'clock, you start thinking, man, I'm hungry, what am I going to do for lunch? And you spend an hour prepping and eating. And then oftentimes it's like, what am I going to do for dinner? We spend like 3 or 4 hours of our day eating or thinking about eating, and then often at night. And eating is good, but eating doesn't help us activate our spirit necessarily. Sometimes it can, I guess. Well, one of the things about fasting is when you fast, you really get to know your own spirit. That's one of the benefits of fasting, is you start to tap into like the inner you, and you're like, what's really inside of me? Is there, when there's anger inside of you, boy, it comes out when you fast. You know, if there's like pain inside of you, you start to tap that pain. Because you don't think about it, because we're always just like, if we feel pain, we're just like, oh, well, I'll just eat, you know. And a lot of times, you kind of hear the story of when, you know, the guy breaks up with a girl and she goes and gets the huge tub of ice cream, right? And she consoles herself by eating copious amounts of ice cream. You know, the guy who just, you know, you feel down and you go eat like 5 burgers from like wherever, right? Anyone ever do that before? I do that. But when you're fasting, you can't, and so you really tap into your spirit. I want to encourage you to find ways to get to know your own spirit. Because who you are is not just the physical you. You will exist forever. Everyone just say forever.
Forever.
Put your hand on your heart and say forever.
Forever. Forever.
Okay. Come on, thank you, black man. That, forever.
Forever.
You actually will exist forever. God promises us a new body, which is, you know, I've seen my spiritual body. It's incredibly buff.
Seeing by the eyes of faith.
Seeing by the eyes of faith. Yeah. But you will exist forever. And it's going to be the same spirit that God has breathed in you will be the same, will be that spirit. Get to know your own spirit. Paul says, I serve God in my spirit, in the good news of his son. Without ceasing, I make mention of you, always in my prayers. I want to say this about verse 9 as well. John 6, verse 60 to 63. Jesus actually just got done preaching. If you got a Bible, you can quickly turn there. If not, I'll just read it to you. But he just got preaching one of the most intense sermons probably ever recorded, ever. He's telling people, I'm the bread of life, and you got to eat my flesh and drink my blood, and they're all like, he basically had a house full. He probably had 300 to 500 people following him at that time, and he preaches this sermon, and everybody leaves him except his 12 disciples. And then Jesus was just so secure in his identity in the Father, he actually turns to his 12 disciples and says, you guys gonna leave too? It's not like he said it like, oh, please don't leave me. Everybody else has now. He was like, he totally knew what he was doing. Jesus was really great at like clearing out the masses and just focusing in on the ones. And they were all following him because the miracles and all, you know, he's just doing all this crazy stuff. And then in verse 60 in John 6, it says, when many of the disciples heard it, they said, this is a hard saying, who could listen to it? But Jesus, knowing in himself that his disciples were grumbling about this, said to them, do you take offense at this? Then what if you were to see the Son of Man descending to where he was before? Verse 63 says, it is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh is of no help at all. Another version says, the flesh profits nothing. The words I have spoken to you are spirit, and they are life. And so that's why it's really important that we learn our spirit and begin to hear with our spirit. Because the way that God speaks to us is he speaks to us in our spirits. Some people are like, well, I don't know. I don't know about the voice of God. I have never heard the voice of God. It's probably because you haven't learned to listen with your spirit. You haven't gotten to know your own spirit. Because when you get to know your spirit, you'll get to know his voice. Because the words he speaks to us are spirit. And so the only way that they connect is in spirit. And in truth. Does that make sense? It's powerful. When we begin to learn our spirit, we hear God so much clearer. We hear his voice clearer. We know his presence more. It's just an awesome, awesome reality. Paul says, I serve God with my spirit without ceasing, making mention of you in my prayers. He's praying all the time. He's just going for it. That at last I may succeed in coming to you, for I long to see you, that I may impart to you some spiritual gift to strengthen you. Paul's all like, I'm the man, Apostle Paul, and one of the reasons I want to see you is so that I can give some of what I got to you just to strengthen you in the areas that you're weak. I love that. And That's a big thing, but I love the next verse, and I want to park on here for a few minutes. Verse 12 says this, that is, that we may be mutually encouraged by each other's faith, both of yours and mine. Can I get really vulnerable with you guys for a few minutes? Okay? I'm going to anyway. I just want to just prep just your heart. I think that my biggest weakness as a leader has been my independence, or my feeling taking all the weight and all the responsibility on myself. And when I've done that, because I know, like, I can be up here and lead worship, I'm all right at it. Apparently, I'm not as good as Jesse. But nonetheless, I've been told through the years that I'm really good. And so I can do that, and I'm strong, and I can do that. I can preach, and I can share, some say. I can do that. And I can minister, I can pray for people. I can basically, like, run the service by myself every time. Like, if I wanted to, if I could come here, set up the sound, do everything, and then you guys come and just kind of receive, and it's just Pastor Josh doing everything. This really came alive to me. I went to I won't mention the church, but I went to a church, and very literally, the pastor did everything. Everything. He, like, opened the prayer, and he did, and there's some hymns and stuff like that, and I think he might have led the hymns, I think. I can't remember that, but then he preached, and then they brought up the Sunday school kids, and he led the Sunday school service. He gave the Sunday school message in front of the whole church. I don't know if anyone has been to a church like this, where the Sunday school goes up to the front, and everybody hears the Sunday school message, and it's the pastor that's doing everything. Then the kids disperse back to their parents, and then he gives the adult sermon. And then he gives the benediction, like the closing, and then, benediction's the closing?
Yeah.
And then it's done. The Lord bless you and keep you, vice shine upon you, all that. And that was it. Pastor did everything. And when I was looking at that, I'm like, man, like, how come there's nobody else involved in this church? But I realized, I kind of judge at the moment, I'm like, this church, come on, like, there's lots of people here, you know? And I remember when I walked in, I just felt really unwelcome, because the greeter was just like, how's it going? And he just gave me, like, the little form that had the thing, and I'm like, okay. There was some other people that came up to me and were like, hey, are you new, blah, blah, blah. And that's when we weren't doing Sunday morning services. And I think I kind of judged that guy, but I realized, like, man, I do that. I think that the whole weight of everything rests on me. And I love what Paul said. He said, I want you to know, or he said, that is that we may be mutually encouraged by each other's faith. And so often, I feel like I don't even know where people's faith is at, because I've never used them. I've never seen, like, hey, where's this person really at? Where's their faith at? So much so, I think God had to make me, like, sick. He didn't make me sick. I was sick just because I was. But I was laying in bed, and I'm like, God, I will get up and just do this. And he was just like, no, James. And I'm like, James. And I'm like, I'm thinking, I don't even know if James can speak. Like, he can talk. But I don't know if he can preach, because I don't know, James. James is kind of weird. Like, he's kind of crazy. I don't know, like, he's just this, like, rock guitar guy. And I don't know, like, can he actually do it? And I'm like, so James' message was so much better than any of yours. That's basically what I heard. She said it was so refreshing. and a breath of fresh air. James is so humble and good looking and down to earth. And I'm like, I added humble.
You were
so
exaggerated.
I know, I'm just making some fun. But she said, he's so down to earth and it was so refreshing and just so good. And I was so encouraged and pretty much all that. She said all that, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. And I'm like, well, it's a good thing I didn't preach this morning because that would have been bad. You know, but I just realized, man, James has something inside of him that I think I don't even necessarily have. Like, just a different gift mix and a different anointing. And so I recognized here that Paul, he wasn't being polite. Paul wasn't like, I'm the Apostle Paul, the freaking man. And I'm the untouchable Apostle Paul that's going to write, you know, half the Bible, Paul. He actually wasn't being polite when he said, I actually want to meet with you guys. One of the reasons I want to meet is because you've got something that I need too. And you've got faith, and you've got gifts, and you've got stuff that I want impartation from. And I want to rub shoulders with you, not so I can just give you stuff, but so that you can give me stuff. And I think that when we have that mentality, that we can grow a lot more. And definitely as a pastor, I'm realizing like, man, I don't have everything in me. I've got like one thing. I'm kind of like a one-trick pony. Really. I totally am. You know what my gift is? Faith and evangelism. I can see and I can prognosticate the success of what God wants to do. And I say it all the time. I'm like, this is what God wants to do. Boom, and I give it to you. And people, and you guys believe it. I know you wouldn't be sitting here unless you believed something. You're stirred up for something. And because, you know, my faith rubs off on you, and I know that. And I need to keep going with that because that's what I'm good at. And I want to get stronger and more balanced and more full in that anointing and in that gifting. But man, am I not down to earth? I'm not down to earth. Like, my mind is in the clouds every day. Now, I can get down to earth. We have an opportunity to do some marriage counseling, Carly and I. And so we're not even married yet. We're going to do marriage counseling. So whatever that means. Not marriage counseling. That's the wrong. Premarital sessions. Really cool story, really quick. 2 years ago, apparently I ran up to this couple and I was witnessing to them. And then I said to them, I said, I have a good feeling about you guys as a couple. Never said that before in my life or since, but apparently I said that. And the guy contacted me, found the card that I gave him, contacted me and said, hey, I want to get married. Me and my girlfriend want to get married. Will you do our wedding? And so Carly and I met with them last 2 weeks ago, and they're just the sweetest couple, aren't they, babe? They're so cool, and they got their heads on straight. They're just not believers. Or I don't actually know if they're believers. We never asked them. But we're going to do premarital counseling with them and help them get a foundation and everything like that, because they're going to get married anyway. So I feel like I would usually never do that, but it's a cool opportunity. So I need to get down to earth for that. That's, you know, one of those pastoral things. What am I saying? I'm saying that you guys are amazing, and I need your faith. I need your faith. Last week, actually it was in January, I felt the Lord stirring my heart to do a fast. And I said that I wouldn't talk about it unless I felt to, but I have to this week because you'll know why in a second. I felt to do a fast, and I felt like God said, yeah, 7 days. And I'm like, 7 days? No problem. And then I started on February 1st, and all of a sudden, the first day of the fast, I started feeling like 40 days. And I'm like, 40 days? Like, I thought you said 7 days. 40 is longer than seven. And so I did the Friday the first, and then the second night I ate dinner. broken. And then I got back on the wagon on the 3rd, which was last week, and I thought that the Lord was calling me to do a 40-day fast. And so I got up here and proclaimed, I'm doing a 40-day fast. I'm the freaking man. You guys are all so lucky to have me as your pastor. And we're going to multiply. It's going to be awesome. And so I went. I actually fasted, and it was awesome. Fast 5 days, it was I just drew close to God. It was an amazing time. And at the end of Thursday, I felt the Lord say, hey, your fast is done. And I'm like, no, it's not. I'm going 40 days. I already told the church we're going 40 days. And I kind of felt like he's like, you are going 40 days. And I'm like, you just said I'm done. And so I was like confused. And I didn't break it till like, I kind of felt like God made me. It was like 1:30 in the morning and I'm laying there in bed, can't sleep. And I'm like, you know, when you fast, your stomach is burning and all that stuff, good stuff, you're just hungry. And I'm like, and God's like, no, break your fast, you're done. And I'm like, okay. So I went and ate chicken noodle soup and I broke my fast. And the next morning, and I ate a few other things. And then, and the next morning, I just felt this like stirring and I'm like, God, what's up? I know you told me to break my fast. And then I remembered 7 years ago, I did a 40-day fast that actually was like one of the best things I ever did. And I did it from March 1st to April 9th of 2006, juice and water fast. And it was like, after I was done that fast, the next, it was when the healing anointing broke through and we started seeing miracles. And since then, we've probably seen upwards, like in the thousands for sure, of healings and just people getting touched by the power of God. It's been awesome. And I felt like the Lord spoke to me and said, this was just a foretaste of what you're going to do, because you're going to fast 40 days from March 1st to April 9th of this year. And it's exactly 7 years later, and I don't know all the significance. I'm sure there's some prophetic significance about that. And so I'm gonna. That's why I think the Lord was stirring my heart. And if I was more spiritually sensitive, I'd probably have known that. That's what we're gonna do. But I realized, like, man, when I'm fasting, when I'm doing that type of fast, I'm not gonna be able to preach. Just because, like, you know, it's kind of like Jesus. Like when Jesus fasted, he went into the wilderness, like literally into the wilderness, and got away from everybody. He wasn't doing meetings. He wasn't talking to people. He was just, I think he was just sitting alone with God day and night, loving Jesus, drawing close to God. People are like, oh, the wilderness season is a season of just like, you're away from God and you don't feel anything. I don't think that's wilderness. I just think people kind of somehow, you know, get into a dry place. But that's not the wilderness that Jesus is talking about. When Jesus went into the wilderness, that was a time of intimacy with God and drawing close to God and drawing away from people. And so what we're going to do is, I talked to Ron and Debbie. They have a nice big room in their house. And we're going to do a core group meeting, not tonight, but next Sunday. And for 6 weeks, I think, I'm not positive, but we're going to work it out. I'm not going to preach. I'm going to get you guys to preach. Some of you guys to preach the message, and Jesse and Austin and whoever else is going to lead worship. And I'm going to literally take 40 days and push into God. I'm still going to do a few things. I'm going to come. I'll be sitting right there partaking and letting some people shine and seeing what happens. I'm still going to be inviting people out like crazy on Facebook because it doesn't involve movement. But I'm going to set my office upstairs. One of my big things is I was walking up, and if you guys have been to my house, the bathroom is upstairs, and it's up like 25 stairs. And so you got to walk up this, when you're just drinking a lot of water, so you're peeing like 50 times a day. And you're walking up and down, up and down, up and down, up and down, up and down. And it's just so taxing on a body that doesn't have fuel. In the natural. And so what I'm understanding about myself is that, and about this church, is that it's gonna be a team effort. Amen?
Amen.
And I always knew that, and I preach it, and I know it, and I preach it, and it's time for us to do it. Like Chris Vallotton says, he says, if you're a Christian, you are in full-time ministry, according to the Bible. It's actually, you guys are if you're not on paid staff of the church, you guys are actually the ministers in the Bible. You're the ones that are called to do the stuff. Everything that Jesus did, you're called to do. Isn't that cool? But you'll never be able to do it unless you step out and do it. And so we need to create a culture where we get people involved in something quick and get them moving toward their actual, you know, calling, instead of just hearing. We need to get people doing. And so that's going to be good. So y'all know where Ron, I'm sure we'll let everyone know next week and stuff, but next Sunday, which is the 17th at 6 to 8 p.m. we're going to do a core group meeting, and we're going to set up some preachers, and you guys are going to give some messages, and I'm going to pray for you, and it's going to be good. Does that sound good?
Yeah.
One of the reasons is because I need your faith. I'm going to be sitting on the front row taking notes about whatever you're talking about, whatever is inside of you to preach, whatever is inside of you to give, and shakarabande, it's going to be a good thing. And so, that is good. We're almost done. I just feel the Lord on that. Yeah. You want to come up and say it, or you just want to say it?
Yeah, I got one for
you. Yeah, come.
All right. I just want to say, like, Pastor Josh here, he's been, like, digging in deep for a while, and he's been doing some awesome stuff here, and I still remember, it was, like, the first week here, we had, like, just the guitar, bongos, I don't even think we had PAs, or we had, like, the small ones, didn't have a keyboard yet, and I still remember when there was one week we had a table set up back there. We just had a meeting, and there was only five of us here, and came from that to actually having, like, our sound guy have all the sound stuff up here, and I think it's really cool, and even though, like, I don't know about you guys, but my faith has been up and down, like, Pastor Josh has been pushing through, and it's really inspired me to just keep pushing through and keep going, so I just really pray that you guys would do the same thing.
We're actually... Stay here for a sec. We just started another youth cell on Wednesday nights. And so I actually just want to just pray for that this morning. And just, I want us to just be in agreement. Because one of the things that the Lord has called this church to do is reach young people. Reach people of all ages for sure, and don't feel bad if you're like, well, I don't know if I'm young and
young,
but there's an anointing and a grace to see people, young people, get saved and get brought into the kingdom. And so we're gonna just hit this up. I want you to pray, Brandon, just out over that youth cell and what God wants to do. Just pray for 30 seconds and just release your faith for that. And we're going to believe God together just that we're going to see the increase. We're going to see people getting saved and getting plugged in and God getting on fire for Jesus.
All right, Jesus, Lord, I just pray that anybody that you call to just grow up and be a leader, grow into their calling, I just pray that you... just put that on their heart, just and fill them with the Holy Spirit, and give them that overflow, show them the love, like, more love every single day. I just pray that every single day as I'm on my walk, or Pastor Josh, or anybody who's on their walk, I just pray that people see something different. And Lord, I just pray that we reach people and multitudes start coming to Christ. Have a youth group of thousands. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Man, that's a good prayer. All right. This is the last section here. Also, I want you to know, brothers, that I have often, and that word brothers in the Greek actually refers, it means brothers and sisters. It's a kind of unisex verse. It says brothers, but it means brothers and sisters. I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that I've often intended to come to you, but thus far I've been prevented, in order that I may reap some harvest among you as well as the rest of the Gentiles. I am under obligation both to Greeks and to barbarians, both to wise and to foolish, so I'm eager to preach the gospel to you also who are in Rome. The last thing I just want to mention this morning is that Paul uses the word obligation to define his urgency in preaching the gospel. Now, there's been kind of an ideology, I guess, or a doctrine or something floating around, and I've heard it time and time and time and time again, and it's rather annoying and definitely unbiblical, and it's the mentality that I just have to obey God when I kind of feel like it, or I just, you know, I'm in the mood, you know, I'm secure in my identity in Christ, so I don't need to do anything I don't want to do. I'm just kind of going to be led by the Spirit, and you know, if God wants me to do something, He'll just automatically give me the courage to do it. I won't have to fight. I won't have to try. I won't have to push. I don't have to do any of that kind of stuff. That's all like for those strivers over there. And you guys know what I'm saying? Like this is, I've heard that time and time again, but I've actually, number one, it's not biblical. Number two, there's no fruit that comes out of that. Because it's so evident in Scripture that faith is a fight. And Paul uses the word obligation to, now I believe it's an awesome privilege to be able to share Jesus with people. That's for certain. There's no doubt it's a privilege. But Paul actually, he refers to it as an obligation. The way that we enter into what God has for us, and the way that you enter into what God has for you, is through obedience. It's through obedience to His voice and to what He is speaking to you. The way that I will enter into what God has for me and will continue to do that as a church is through obedience. Obedience is the word that the Bible uses to describe those who walk in a greater measure of the Holy Spirit's power. The Bible says that God gives the Holy Spirit to those who obey Him in Acts chapter 5. God gives the Holy Spirit to those who obey Him. There are many, many Christians that have the Holy Spirit in them, but they don't have the Holy Spirit on them for powerful ministry because they don't walk in obedience. They sense His presence on a daily basis, but in order to walk in the power of the Spirit, in order to see viable miracles, in order to see an increase of His power and presence in and through your life, we must push into obedience to His voice, which is faith. The Bible says in Romans 9, faith comes by hearing by the word of God. That word hearing is in the Greek present tense. It doesn't mean I read my Bible and now I have faith. It means I'm hearing His voice in my spirit, and I'm walking in the Spirit, and because of that, that is what faith is. I'm walking in faith. It's a good word for some of us. It's a tough word, but Paul embraced it, and that's why it bore so much fruit. Because he recognized, this isn't an option for me. It's not a make or break salvation thing, but it is a make or break fruit thing. You guys with me? Paul says I'm under obligation. Debarbarians. I'm under obligation to Greeks, to barbarians, both to wise and foolish. And then he says, since I'm under obligation anyway, I'm just gonna get passionate about it. So I'm eager to come to you too. And so I want to pray that we would see that, because something that I know that is in the heart of God is to see, like, what's the name of our church again?
Dunamis.
Oh, Dunamis, right. That word means power. It's the power to perform miracles. It's the power to see God's kingdom come. There's no kingdom, there's no gospel without dunamis. There's no substance without, there's no life without God's power. There's no being a witness without his power. Right? Jesus said, wait in Jerusalem until the Holy Spirit endues you with power from on high. Then you will be my witnesses. It's not even fun to try to convince someone to believe the gospel without the power of God. It's not even fun. It's not even biblical. And it's not fun, which is like a double negative. No, that doesn't make it possible. And I know, I just wonder, like, so I want to pray for us this morning that we'll get that fire, that passion, and that we'll realize God's calling me. Number one, I belong to him, my identity's secure, but he's calling me to be his witness. He's calling me to be his witness. And he's put on me not just an opportunity, but an obligation. And if I will be sensitive to his spirit, I'll begin to hear that voice. And I'll begin to walk in the fruitfulness that he wants me to walk in. So, you guys good?
Yeah.
Let's stand up. Thank you, Lord. Father, in Jesus' name, I just thank you for this morning. I thank you, Lord, for every heart that is here, every spirit that is engaged with you this morning, God. And I ask you, Lord, why don't you guys just open up your hands right now? I ask you for an infilling and an overflowing of your presence. Lord, I thank you that we can know that we are completely forgiven, that we are blood-bought, that you own us, that there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ. But I also thank you, Lord, for every gifting and calling that's represented here, for every person that has stuff inside of them that I need and that all of us need what each other has to offer. It doesn't come in all in a speaking gift or something like that, but it all comes by just fellowship and working together. And Lord, I also pray that we would sense the urgency of the gospel. That this is not, it's a matter of life and death. The gospel saves sinners. The gospel brings people into the arms of the Father. The gospel brings people into a place of life when they were dead. And I pray that we would see that this morning, God, and feel it. Spirit of God, I thank you that your presence is here. Would you fill every person under the sound of my voice? And would you just put that mantle on them, God? That mantle of your presence and just that grace. Thank you, Lord, for the good news, the gospel of your kingdom this morning. Amen.
Amen.
All right. You guys are awesome. We're going to take... you guys